Good morning, good morning. I am Pastor Tony. Welcome to LifeSpring today, whether you're here in present in the auditorium or if you're online. You know what I thought we would do as we begin? Let's just together as a big group of people, let's just tell God Happy Father's Day. Can we do that on three? One, two, three. Happy Father's Day, God. Give him a hand. Give God a hand. So welcome to LifeSpring today. I'm so glad that you're with us. Happy Father's Day to all the fathers who are joining us here today, either here or online. I'm sure you've all been made to feel special today. For Mother's Day, you know, my lovely wife provided a little something for all the ladies, you know, a nice a pretty little pink bag, and inside the bag were a little starry bag, right, with a drawstring and some mints, and there was a medal inside that says, "You make a difference," with a nice pink, you know, lanyard, and I thought, well, guys, I can't be outdone by my wife, right? You obviously don't know my wife. I could be easily outdone by my wife, but I did the best I could. But I figured, guys, who wants a pink bag, right? No, Scott does. Okay, besides Scott. So, guys, I gave you a bag that is functional for you, right? And so I got some guys that are going to be passing out your brown paper bags, and guys, inside this bag, you will not find, and look what you've got on the outside. You don't have a pretty cute card. You got Spider-Man, all right? Am I right, guys? Come on, am I right here? And inside this bag, you're not going to find a cute little drawstring bag. No, you've got a reusable Ziploc bag. And I know you save these, guys. I know you do. I've got a reusable Ziploc bag on my workbench that contains all of my reusable Ziploc bags, okay? I know what you're going to do with this. And you do make a difference, but there's no pink on your lanyard, okay? I tried to get gold and purple for obvious reasons, but I thought there might be some people that would, you know, not like that. So gold and black, guys, gold and black. And inside, there's no mints. No siree. Potato chips. And you can eat them in the service while I'm talking, guys, all right? Is that a happy Father's Day gift? That's right. Oh, and did you notice there was no pretty ribbon tying this together? No, there were staples. And not just any staples, guys. I am talking about the Ryobi XP 2000 Power Stapler with 65 horse to the jaws. I stapled your bag. It's not going anywhere. That's right. For those of us from that generation, we know what we're doing here, right? Oh, man. Girly for the girls, but manly for the mans. Amen, guys? All right. Raising kids is tough. Amen? Can I get an amen to that? Raising kids is tough in this world. It's like growing trees. Now, I got to tell you, when we first moved into our house here in Moore Park, my wife and I planted a beautiful orchard of fruit trees in our backyard. We planted 8 gorgeous fruit trees with the promise of deliverance. About 6 of them died. We planted 6 more. About 4 of them died. Finally, someone in church gave me a coupon for Michaels. They had a sale on silk trees. Growing trees is tough business. Growing trees is hard. Raising kids is hard. Raising kids is like growing trees. And there is a vast difference between a bonsai tree and a redwood, right? I mean, there's a vast difference between a bonsai tree and a redwood. Both can be found in this area. Sylvia and I take walks, and there's people that bonsai their trees in their front yard. And then there's some tall pines and redwoods, you know, here in Moore Park. We like bonsai trees. We like bonsai trees because of their clean lines and their elegant features, their uniqueness. We like bonsais because bonsai trees are created in our own image, right? We fashion the tree the way we want it to be. And people look at our bonsai tree and they think we're cool. People raise kids like that. But a bonsai tree requires constant attention. Trees don't grow like bonsai trees naturally, right? I mean, I've never been hiking in the Sierras and said, oh my, look at that bonsai tree, right? I mean, they don't grow that way normally or naturally. Bonsais are created when you take a normal tree and you put it in a pot that's too small for it. And then you constantly clip it and prune it so it looks the way you want it to look instead of the way God created it to look. Bonsai trees cannot be ignored. You ignore a bonsai tree one time and it'll wither and die because it's been conditioned to being over-controlled. And the minute you stop, it's over. Now, both species of redwood trees growing in California, they grow essentially on their own, right? They grow on their own. They grow over time. Nobody trims them. Nobody prunes them. They grow at their own pace, at their own rate. Their growth is conditioned by the difficulties that they face, right? The fires, the winds, the torrential downpours, all of it work to make the redwood tree what it is and give it its character. Redwood trees actually grow interdependently. Their root systems under the ground begin to merge, and sometimes even redwoods that are growing next to each other are not seedlings, they're actually sprouts from the same root system. Growing side by side. They learn to share water and nutrients. As a result, they endure for thousands of years. The oldest coastal redwoods in California are like 2,500 years old. The oldest giant sequoias are like 3,200 years old. They were around when Jesus was born. Then there's this. It's a bonsai redwood. A bonsai redwood is a contradiction, all right? Someone has gone to a lot of time and trouble and work To make something miss its destiny. Some parents raise their kids with the bonsai method, right? They're just hovering over controlling, making sure everything is done in the right way. Some use the redwood method, hands off, let nature run its course. Believe it or not this morning, God doesn't call us to either of those kinds of parenting. So what's the third option? Well, would you believe that this bonsai requires no pruning? This happens naturally. It requires no fertilizer. Everything it needs is internal to itself. It actually requires no water, if you can believe that. This is a fast food bonsai. It does require a little dusting now and then. You can buy it on Amazon for $16.95. It's plastic. Works for me. But some people like the idea of plastic children. Two, clear expectations, no problems. That's bonsaiing your children to the extreme. Little cookie cutter replicas of some ideal that's in our heads. But God created your child in His image from birth. Your job is to discover who your children were meant to be and develop them into the child of God that He created, not the one that you fashioned them into. So on this Father's Day, I want to ask the question, does God want us to raise our children to be bonsais or redwoods, or does He have a better way? Is there something in between? Go ahead and open your Bibles or Bible apps this morning to Psalm 78. Psalm, if you open your Bible in the middle, You'll be somewhere in the Psalms. You can go to Psalm 78. There's a note-taking outline that is in the back of the auditorium. If you haven't found it, you can pull that out. It's got the note-taking outline and the action plan for the week so you can apply the lesson to your life. These things are also on the app and on the website so you can follow along this week and apply the lesson during the week into your lives. Let's go ahead and stand this morning and read God's Word together. We're going to be reading the first three verses from Psalm 78. It's on the screen behind us. Let's read it together. Oh, my people, listen to my instructions. Open your ears to what I am saying. For I will speak to you in a parable. I will teach you hidden lessons from our past, stories we have heard and known, stories our ancestors handed down to us. Let's pray and ask God to teach us. Father, take your word this morning, written in this particular case 3,000 years ago. But wisdom that has endured to this day because it's wisdom that stands the test of time. And I pray that you would help us as we glean from your Holy Spirit this morning how to be the parents to our children, to our grandchildren, to the children of this church that you call us to be. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Go ahead and have a seat this morning. So it's important for us to learn history so that we can avoid making the same mistakes that those who came before us made. Mistakes are valuable only and if we learn from them and apply the lessons that we learn to our lives to make our lives better. This psalm was written by a guy named Asaph. Asaph was a musician in David's court about 1000 B.C., and he wrote this psalm so that the Israelites could avoid the mistakes that their ancestors had made. And as a member of the worship team there in Jerusalem 3,000 years ago, he was keenly acquainted with the mistakes that the Israelites had made. In Deuteronomy chapter 6, Moses instructs the Israelites in the Shema that Pastor Paul talked to us about a few weeks ago. And in the Shema, he gives instructions about how we are to pass on the godly truths that God has given to us to our children. 500 years after Moses gives the Israelites the Shema, Israel hasn't done a very good job of passing on those truths to their children. So Asaph now feels the need to repeat the lesson. Raising children like bonsais, create over-controlled, deformed miniatures of what God intended. But raising children like redwoods creates a society in which everyone does what seems right in their own eyes, and pretty much everybody goes crazy. We are living right now in the aftermath of a generation that raised redwoods. And all of the moral moorings have been broken. Society is kind of, everybody's doing what seems right instead of what is declared right. Neither situation is ideal. The people around you need to see something different. They need to see how your relationship with Christ positively affects you in the context of issues that they care about. And we live in Ventura County. We live in Moor Park. Our church is in Moor Park. And in Moor Park, in Ventura County, raising children is an issue that everybody cares about. This is a child-centric county. And as the people around you watch you in the way you raise your children, you can give a testimony of the power and the grace and the glory of God. So how do we thread the needle between a bonsai and a redwood in raising your children? How do you exercise the proper balance of control and freedom? Irma Bombeck, one of my favorite theologians, she describes raising children like flying a kite. Flying a kite, it can never be a passive experience. You can't just throw the kite up there and tie the string to a tree and expect it to fly, right? It doesn't work that way. No, when the wind is pulling the kite, you've got to let the string go. And then when the wind starts to die down, you've got to pull the string back in. And it's that constant letting it go, pulling it back in, letting it go, pulling it back in that sends your kite flying higher and higher and higher into the sky. And isn't that what we want for our children? We want them to soar over the world that they're inheriting. And so as parents, we've got to thread that needle. We've got to provide that proper balance of control and freedom, control and freedom. Asaph tells us to start by talking to your children and share the lessons from your past. Share the lessons from your past. You know, my wife and I, every once in a while, we'll go out to dinner, and we'll sit in the restaurant, and, you know, we're having conversation, and sometimes it just dawns on us. We're looking around the restaurant, and here are these families sitting at tables and booths all around the restaurant, and they're looking at their phones, they're eating their food, and no conversation at all is taking place. They've gone out to eat, and no conversation at all is taking place at the table. I can imagine what happens at home. They're probably in four different rooms, all watching different TV shows. Talk to your children and share with them the stories from your past. Share with them your spiritual journey. We're going to be offering a Bible study this fall called Experiencing God, Knowing and Doing the Will of God. And one of the exercises in that study is the charting of your spiritual markers. And you will take a week and you will write down all of the spiritual markers of your life. Now, the spiritual markers are those points in your past where God has moved with unmistakable clarity to direct the future direction of your life. And we all have them. And we should know them. And we should know why they're significant, and we should share those with our children. Because if we share our spiritual markers, if we share those lessons with our children, they don't have to learn those same lessons the way we did, which is usually the school of hard knocks. They can learn from us. Talk about them with your children. Oh, my people, listen to my instructions. Open your ears to what I'm saying. For I will speak to you in parables and in stories. I will teach the hidden lessons from our past, stories we've heard and known, stories our ancestors have handed down. Those stories can change their life. Those stories can direct their life. One of the things about LifeSpring that I'm most proud of is the excellent work of our children's ministry team. We have an awesome children's ministry team. We have awesome teachers that week in and week out, you know, plant the word of God into your children, fan the flame, and allow it to grow. Now, but as good as our program is, that cannot be the only time your children hear about God during the week. You make a difference. Look at your medal. Look at your medal. You make a difference. And you need to make a difference. Share with your children and grandchildren regularly how God is moving in your life. Let them see it in you. Let them learn it from you. Help them to see how God is moving in their own lives by seeing how He's moving in your life through your stories. I can remember growing up as a child sitting around the dinner table at family gatherings and hearing my parents and my aunts and my uncles and my grandparents all talking about how they came to this country. On my mother's side, they grew up in England. My mother grew up in London during the war with the bombs dropping all over the place and how they dealt with that situation. My father grew up in Italy without a father. His father had come to the United States and had got separated from his family because of World War II. For 16 years, they were separated. My grandmother raised two boys in a small mountain village in Italy by herself in the middle of World War II. and in the aftermath of World War I. I mean, it was, you hear these stories of courage and faith and valor and choices, self-sacrificial choices. They shaped my life. They shaped my life. I realized what freedom for me cost people that had come before me. We need to tell those stories. And we need to create stories in our own life. I mean, my own name bears the marks of the immigrant experience. They told me it comes from the luggage tags. To New York. T-O-N-Y. I don't think it's true, but they like to tell me that. Keep me in my place. Yeah, you had a different name, but one of the guys at Ellis Island just took the luggage tag and stuck it on your forehead. That's you. That's what they told me. Lovely family. But we need to create experiences for our children as well. My own children, growing up, Sylvia and I would regularly go to the rescue mission in Oxnard. We'd serve meals and we'd lead the service. We'd talk to the guys before they would eat. We'd go to Mexico several times a year and we'd minister to the poor. And my children grew up doing that. My children had a toy box each. That was all their toys had to fit in the toy box. When birthdays would come, when Christmas would come, they had to decide what toys came out of the toy box so the new toys could go in. And then we'd have a garage sale. They'd sell all their new toys. They'd get the money. We'd go to Mexico, and they had their own money to give away to people when we were in Mexico. They grew up learning these lessons personally in their own life. It was part of life for us. God using our family to share the love of Jesus with those who really needed it. And those experiences shaped my children's lives. So my youngest daughter graduated from college, and you know, with her degree in business, she decided to go and be a missionary in China, you know, and we're like, yeah, okay, I guess it makes sense. You know, that's what we trained her to do after we spent $1 million to give her education, which God also used. Read to your children every night. Read before they go to bed the stories that you want to shape their lives. And I'm not talking to the mothers here today. I mean, mothers, you can do that. I'm talking to the fathers. Guys, set the pace. Set the pace. Spidey says to you this morning, spring into action. Swing into action. He says one of those things, swing into action, right? Guys, it's on us. You read to your children when they go to bed at night, and guess what? They will learn that books are important. Mom can read to them all the time, but when dad reads to them, they learn that books are important. When dad reads to them the Bible, they learn that the Bible is important. Read to them the stories that you want to shape their lives. Involve your children in ministry. Work in the children's program, bring your kids in. Let those experiences, let those stories shape their future. You truly do make a difference. As God has worked through his people in the past, he wants to continue to work in the present. Your role is to show God's will for their present. To show God's will for their present. They need to understand what God's will is for them right now. And as we put our children to bed each night as they were growing up, we would read books like The Chronicles of Narnia. We would read books like The Lord of the Rings. My kids knew that The Lord of the Rings was a book before they knew it was a movie and a video game, right? My kids knew it was a book. We read to them, you know, Madeline L'Engle. We read to them the Little House on the Prairie stories. We read to them classics, Robinson Crusoe. We read to them stories of courage and faith and overcoming challenging situations. And then we talked about the struggles that we were facing, and we read the Bible. And we talked about how the Bible would speak into the situations they were having at school or with their friends or on the playground. We allowed God's word to speak into those situations. Men, it's on you to set this example. Our wives can do it, and they should do it, but men, they need to see you do it. Sylvie and I talked about the struggles that we were facing as well. We pray for each other, and when we saw God's answers to those prayers, we talked about those as well. Asaph said, verses 4 through 6, says, we will not hide these truths from our children. We will tell the next generation about the glorious deeds of the Lord, about his power and his mighty wonder. For he issued his laws to Jacob. He gave his instructions to Israel. He commanded our ancestors to teach them to their children so the next generation might know them, even the children not yet born. And they, in turn, will teach their own children. This is 2 Timothy 2:2, circa 3,000 years ago. We're going to teach our children so that they can teach their children, so that those children can teach others also. If we don't do this, we develop bonsai children who, when they grow, go through struggles of their own, they don't know how to deal with them in a godly manner. As parents, we can become so obsessed with the physical nature of the present situation that we miss how God is using that situation redemptively in the lives of our children, how he's using that situation to change and alter and direct their destiny. We can be so reactive to the physical crisis happening in front of us that we miss how that crisis plays into God's plan for developing our children into who they must eventually become. We can be so concerned with what is happening in the moment makes us look or feel that we forget how to make this moment transformational for eternity. Yeah, I don't know what's going on with the air conditioning today. It doesn't seem to be working. I would encourage all of you to do this, and maybe enough wind will make it up here, you know, for me. We want to develop into our children the idea that God is real and actively engaged in their everyday lives. When the federal building in Oklahoma was bombed in April 1995, my daughter Stacy was 10 years old. We watched the news together as a family, and then afterwards, we cried together as a family. And as we prayed that night, as we were putting them to bed, Stacy prayed that God would send someone to share Jesus with the little kids in the preschool that were on the ground floor. And my wife and I looked at one another while she was praying, and we're just like, okay. And then afterwards, I tried to gently and compassionately explain to her that, you know, Stacy, the bombing already happened. Those children are already dead. And then she looked at me quizzically and very patiently explained to me that God can hear her prayer today and send someone yesterday to witness to those children. And then she looked at me and she says, you know that, right, Dad? Yeah. Yeah, I know that. Yeah, of course I know that. Yeah, I was really proud of your prayer. Yeah, that's true. Oh, my goodness. My 10-year-old just taught me about God's transcendent eternity, you know? Oh, my goodness. Oh, God. Thank you, Jesus, for my kids. Now, my kids aren't perfect, right? They make mistakes. They have the same struggles as you and I do all the time, but they need to know, and your children need to know that they know that they know, without a doubt, that God is at work in them even when life isn't going the way any of us have planned. And sometimes life isn't going the way we have planned because of outside circumstances, and sometimes it's not going the way we have planned because we've made some bad choices, and they need to know that God is still working even in those situations. My favorite verse from Proverbs, a man rolls the dice, but the Lord determines the outcome. God is working no matter what we do. You make a difference. You make a difference by living out your confident faith so that they can see it. And by doing that, you give hope for their future. We live in a world of very little hope. Our nation's never been more divided. Society is moving to completely divorce God from real life situations. The church in America has lost a lot of its influence. In such a world, how do we bring hope to our children? By living what you believe. You make a difference. Asaph reminds us, in each generation, we should set our hopes anew on God, not forgetting his glorious miracles and obeying his commands. Then they will not be like their ancestors, stubborn, rebellious, and unfaithful, refusing to give their hearts to God. Last week, we read about the struggles that the Israelites had to stay true to God while they were wandering in the wilderness for 40 years. They learned to renew their faith daily. And so, in so doing, they learned to survive 40 years in enemy territory. It would have been easy for them to look at their life as it appeared and get more than a bit depressed, right? I mean, when all you have to eat is manna day in and day out, I mean, that's, you kind of forget what it means to barbecue a steak, you know? Asaph shares the secret for having hope, even when everything around you seems hopeless. Hope is renewed every day as long as you don't forget who God is and all of the ways that God has been there for you and is there for you today. God is for you today. I don't know what, you know, I know some of you are in difficult circumstances today. I know that. I know there are challenges today. There are challenges looking forward. We don't know. It's a little uncertain. Not sure what's happening. We got health issues. We got relationship issues. We got financial issues. We got challenges in life. But I'm telling you, God is at work in you today. And if you stop and look, remember the stories from your past. Look and see what God is doing. You will see how he's working here today. Share it with your children. You make a difference. You make a difference. And if you're thinking, well, my kids are grown. They're not around here. You know, who do I share it with? Hey, I got an idea. Talk to Nancy Tuttle. Talk to Laura Murphy and get involved in our children's program because there are kids here that need to hear your stories too. This life is not all there is. This life is just a dress rehearsal for the main event, which is coming, the kingdom of God. This life, this is spring training. Jesus told a story about a man who assigned three of his servants a portion of the money and his estate. And the only instruction he gave them about what to do with that money was to teach them what kind of a man he was. He just taught them who he was. And he expected them to use that information to do something with this money that he gave them. At the end of the story, the servants were rewarded on the basis of what they did with the money and what the results were based on what they knew about their master. You have been given resources in this life. You have been given a home. You've been given a car. You've been given a job. You've been given a family. You've been given children and grandchildren. You have been given resources in this life. And God hasn't told you specifically what to do with those resources, but he's told you what kind of person he is. And he wants you to invest those resources for his kingdom based on what you know about him. In case I haven't said it today, you make a difference. You make a difference. You are being trained with what is not yours. If you think your children are yours, ask them. especially your teenagers. Ask your teenagers, do I own you? Can I control you? When you find ones that say yes, let me know. I'd like to make some trades. Not my kids. My kids are perfect. Oh, wait, I already spoiled that. The Apostle Paul writes to us, "For our present troubles are small and won't last very long. Yet they produce in us a glory that vastly outweighs them and will last forever." So we don't look at the troubles we can see now. Rather, we fix our gaze on things that cannot be seen. For the things that we see now are soon be gone, but the things we cannot see will last forever. In the midst of whatever struggles you're facing, bring your children in. Let them know what's happening at an age-appropriate level and ask them to pray with you, knowing that whatever you're going through is going to pass away, and what's going to remain is what you develop, what you build, what you create in that struggle. Allowing your children to see there is hope beyond struggle. Because I guarantee you, no matter how well of a job you do as a parent, your children will struggle. They need to know there's hope beyond the struggle. Constantly remind yourself and your children of that reality. Everything you hear on the news or from your boss or from any other source, it's just temporary inconveniences in light of eternity. What you see as life troubles are just opportunities for God to make you and them into the person he created them to be. You make a difference. Now, if you're here today or if you're listening to this live stream and you've never surrendered the leadership of your life to Jesus Christ, the wisdom and resources to be the man of God that God is calling you to be, they're going to be just out of reach until you make that choice. Until you allow God, until you allow Jesus Christ to be not a religious icon in your life, not a religious figure, not a moral teacher, until you allow him to be the Lord and Savior of your life, you can never be the man of God that he wants you to be. So if you've never surrendered the leadership of your life to Jesus Christ, I invite you to pray with me right now on this Father's Day. Make him your father so that you can be the father you need to be for your children. And if you're a gal here today, you can pray with me too. So let's go ahead and pray. Father, thank you. Thank you for the Word of God. Thank you for the instructions that you've given us. Thank you for the role of privilege and responsibility that you have put us in. We are priests and priestesses in your kingdom and in our family. We're not just trying to get our kids alive to 18. We're trying to raise a generation of godly men and women who are going to change the world. And Lord, you have put the power to do that in our lives. You've put it in our minds. You've put it in our experiences. You've put it in the stories that have defined us. You've put it in the opportunities that we have to show our children a real and loving and living God. You are an amazing father to us. You are the best father we could ever hope for. And Lord, as you become real in us, allow us to be fathers after your own pattern. If there's anyone that has not surrendered the leadership of their life to you, Father, I ask you right now to give them the faith to believe. Lord Jesus, show up in their spirit right now. Call them into your kingdom. And Spirit, give them the courage to answer that call. Lord Jesus, I need you. I need you to be the father, mother, friend, person that I need to be. I need you because I know that there are stuff in my life that is not right. And if I stand before you with those kinds of things, with sin in my life, I'll never make it into your kingdom. Lord Jesus, I need you. be my Savior. Be the captain of my life. And help me to be the person you created me to be. And help me to pass that on to my children and to those around me. I ask it in your name. Amen.
Thank you so much for joining us.